You might be wondering what these images have to do with chemistry, or with each other for that matter. After all, what do airbags and campfires have to do with acid rain and the synthesis of medicines? Yes, they're all common parts of our everyday lives. But what you might not know is that none of them would exist without a little thing called chemical reactions. Today we're investigating chemical reactions. What is a chemical reaction? We've already learned about chemical and physical changes in Unit 2. Physical changes are changes that alter a substance without altering its composition, like ice melting into water. A chemical change, on the other hand, is any change that results in the formation of a new chemical substance, like when water and carbon dioxide combine to form glucose during photosynthesis. It might be hard to observe the chemical reaction during photosynthesis because it involves gases that you can't see. But many reactions show obvious signs of chemical change. Let's look at an example. In this graduated cylinder, I have 50 milliliters of 30% hydrogen peroxide. It's the same stuff you've probably used to treat cuts, just at a higher concentration. I'm going to add 40 milliliters of dish soap. In this beaker, I have a solution of water and potassium iodide. When I mix them together, you'll notice several signs of chemical change. Watch what happens. This is pretty cool, and it's pretty informative if you're paying attention. Now, the first change you might notice was color. It turned brown and then more of a yellow. Obviously, bubbles formed in the liquid. That means the liquid gave off gas, and fast. That's two visible signs of a chemical change. Color change, and the production of gas. A third change wasn't visible, but as the reaction takes place, the mixture's getting warmer. So the third sign is a change in energy, which can be a temperature change, like in this example. It could also be light given off, like the fireworks we talked about in Unit 3. A fourth sign of chemical change is the formation of a precipitate. A precipitate is a solid substance formed in the solution during a chemical reaction. This solution didn't do that, but others often do. Something to keep in mind as you work through this unit. The point is that we can use signs like these to recognize when a chemical reaction occurs. What else is important in chemical reactions? To answer that, let's go to our classroom.
Today we're going to investigate one example of a chemical reaction. So with your lab aprons and your safety glasses on, each group needs to carefully measure out about 2 scoops of sodium bicarbonate, which is this white powder here. You'll also need to mass out acetic acid in a small cup, and that's found in this Erlenmeyer flask here. Now, these are going to act as your reactants. And remember, you want to measure out the mass of the powder and the mass of the acid, but you don't want to include the mass of the cup or the baggie. So talk with each other about the steps that you'll need to take to ensure that the mass of the reactants are correct. And once you've measured the mass of the reactants, we'll go on to the next step.
How are we supposed to take the mass of a liquid? Aren't liquids measured in volume?
I don't think volume and mass are the same thing. Remember, we learned about matter having mass and volume, so the liquid has got to have mass too.
If we measure the mass of the cup first, and then we add the acid, we can subtract the cup's mass from the total, right? Mm-hmm.
Great. That'll give us the mass of just the acid, but what about the powder? We can't just put it on the balance.
You're right. But we can do the same thing with the bag that we did with the cup. We'll just take the mass of the bag and then add the sodium bicarbonate.
Yeah, that's a good plan. But I can show you a way to make this a little bit easier. Since we have this electronic balance, there's a button on it that says zero. On some balances, it'll read tear. But what we can do is we can put the empty cup on the balance, and then we can press the zero button, and you'll notice that the number zeroes out. So essentially, the balance has disregarded the mass of the cup. So now when we add the acid, we're only going to see the mass of that substance. So complete your measurements and then we'll continue. Now that you've measured the masses of the acetic acid and the sodium bicarbonate, write down your reactant mass totals in a chart and take a picture of them so that we can discuss the results later. Now after you've done that, go ahead and finish your lab. But remember to be careful to remove the air from the bag and seal it well before allowing the reactants to touch each other.
Okay, I'll turn the bag so that the acid pours into the sodium bicarbonate. Hey, look, it's puffing up.
Hey, touch the bottom of the bag. It's getting cool.
Temperature changes about energy. So is the energy coming or going?
That's a great observation. The temperature change is a sign of the energy moving. And cooling means that the reaction is pulling in energy from the surroundings. And we'll learn a lot more about energy later on in the course. So don't forget to write the mass of the bag and the mass of the cup separately before you put your product mass totals onto your spreadsheets. Okay, I've got both teams' results up here on the monitor. So let's look at the data. What do you notice?
Our numbers are almost the same before and after. I don't know why, because the bag puffed up, so the product should have been bigger.
Our bag didn't puff up.
And your product is smaller.
Why do you think your data's different?
Maybe our bag leaked, and that's why it didn't puff up.
All right, so let's think about that. Your bag didn't puff up, and the product had less mass. So what is it that makes the bag puff up?
It's the gas, like when you blow up a balloon.
But gases don't have mass, do they? I don't feel anything.
Gases must have mass. Our bag didn't puff up and had less mass, but their bag did puff up and had more mass.
You're right. Gases do have mass. And if we think back to our definition of matter, it's anything that has mass and takes up space. So if we're looking at the data, what does it mean to say the mass is the same before and after the reaction?
Well, it must mean that nothing happened.
The bag puffed and it got cold. Something must have happened.
Okay, nice job recognizing some signs of chemical reactions, because a chemical reaction did take place. And except for the leaky bag, what we have demonstrated is the law of conservation of mass or matter. So what does conservation mean?
Saving something?
It's saving mass, right? We had the same amount of mass at the beginning as we had at the end.
Right. The law of conservation of matter says that matter cannot be created or destroyed. It can only be changed from one form to another. Or in other words, you're going to end up with what you started with. And chemists represent this in a balanced chemical equation like this one up on the monitor. And this is the reaction that we just did in lab. So what do you think it means to have a balanced equation?
Equations like math, they show what's equal to something else.
But there's no equal sign here.
That's right. But for a chemist, an equation shows the reactants being converted to products. And the arrow is kind of like an equal sign. And the little letters at the bottom, they're going to indicate the state or the phase that each substance is in. So for an S, that would indicate that that substance is in the solid phase. A G represents gaseous. An L would be liquid. And AQ means aqueous, or in other words, is dissolved in water. And the balance part comes from having the same number of atoms on each side of the arrow. So if you'll count the sodium atoms, you'll notice that there's one sodium on the reactant side. There's one sodium on the product side. Now check the oxygen. Now when you do this, be careful and make sure that you add up all the oxygen from each side. How many are there?
So there's 5 on each side.
Wait, how did you get that?
Okay, so there's 2 in the carbon dioxide, right? 1 in the water, and 2 in the sodium bicarbonate.
Yeah, I see now.
So keep checking, and I think you're going to find that there's the same number of hydrogen atoms and carbon atoms on both sides of the equation, too. How many of those do you guys count?
I see that there are 3 carbon atoms and 5 hydrogen atoms on each side of the equation.
You counted the atoms exactly right. Now what we're going to do is look at another type of a chemical reaction. Let's explore the process of water forming from oxygen gas and hydrogen gas. Now this one's a little bit more challenging, so let's use some models. And these are from my molecular modeling kit. And the white, they represent hydrogen. And the red represents oxygen.
Why are there 2 hydrogens together instead of just 1?
Isn't hydrogen one of the diatomics we talked about before?
Yeah, and so is oxygen.
You remember that?
Yeah, I heard about a funny word to help you remember, Brinkelhoff. H is for hydrogen, O is for oxygen, and the rest of the diatomics.
That's a great trick for remembering the diatomics. Now I want you guys to use your molecular models and create water molecules.
We We made one water molecule, and we had one oxygen atom left.
Us too.
I thought oxygen atoms couldn't be by themselves.
You're right. So how can we fix this problem?
If we take the other oxygen back from the water molecule, then we have diatomic oxygen and hydrogen again.
So nothing changed?
That's true. But is there another solution out there that you can think of?
If we had another molecule of hydrogen, we could make another water molecule with the oxygen molecule.
Okay, I do have another hydrogen molecule. There you go. Okay, to make these two water molecules, how many oxygen molecules did you have to start with?
Well, we started with one molecule of oxygen.
And how many hydrogen molecules did you start with?
After adding the extra, we had two diatomic hydrogen molecules to make the two water molecules.
Good job. Scientists also use chemical equations as models. In chemical equations, they represent the atoms, molecules, or formula units that are actually reacting or forming a chemical reaction. So let's get some practice with chemical equations. How can you represent the amount of hydrogen, oxygen, or water in a chemical equation? And as you'll recall from Unit 4, we can use the chemical symbols for elements from the periodic table, and we can use subscripts to indicate the number of the atoms, and we can use coefficients to indicate the number of molecules. So try writing an equation for the reaction that occurs when hydrogen joins oxygen to form water. And if you would, write your equation on your whiteboard. Okay, would you guys like to explain your equation? Mm-hmm.
So since we had two molecules of hydrogen, we wrote hydrogen twice and wrote one oxygen molecule. And the arrow, it points to the product, the two water molecules.
Nice work. How does your equation look?
We did basically the same thing, but we grouped like terms, the same way we do it in math.
So our equation says two hydrogen molecules plus one oxygen molecule forms two water molecules.
Great. And both of your answers are actually correct balanced equations, and they both demonstrate the law of conservation of matter. And the reason being is you have the same number of each element on both sides of the equation. No substance was created, no substance was destroyed. Now, chemists usually write their balanced equations with the like terms grouped, similarly to the way you two did. And now, you mentioned that hydrogen is a gas. How could you represent that in your equation?
We can write G for gas and L for liquid water.
Good. Now, most often, chemists balance equations without the physical models. And we do this by changing coefficients in the equation. Now, coefficients are the numbers that are found in front of the chemical substance, and they represent the quantity needed for the reaction to occur. So in a balanced equation, the total number of each type of atom will be the same on both sides of the equation. Now, there are three major steps to balancing chemical equations. The first thing you need to do is count the number of different elements on each side of the equation. Second, you need to adjust the coefficients so that the number of each element is the same on both the reactant side and the product side. Now, third, you need to check your work by recounting. Remember, the coefficient is distributed over the entire compound. So if there are two water molecules, there are actually going to be four hydrogen atoms and only two oxygen atoms. And I know that seems kind of weird at first, but once you practice it for a while, it gets easier and faster. And this is something that is extremely important to chemists. Now on your whiteboard, I'd like you to try to write an example for this reaction. And it's going to be magnesium reacts with oxygen gas to produce magnesium oxide.
That's a lot to think about, but our teacher's right. It gets much easier with practice. For now, try writing the chemical equation for the magnesium reaction our teacher just assigned. And remember to follow the three steps he mentioned. And if you want a little extra practice, check out our Closer Look video on balancing equations. There's also a Closer Look video on the law of conservation of matter you can watch. In the next video on the playlist, we'll discuss chemical equations you wrote for the magnesium reactions and learn about different types of chemical reactions. I'll see you there.